Well, you may get out early today. Tell you what, I don't know how long my voice is going to hold out, but I want to hear "To God Be the Glory." Everybody turn to page 19. I want to hear that before I preach. 19. Turn with me in your Bibles to the book of Hebrews chapter 11. I'm going to look at two verses of Scripture. Hebrews chapter 11. Also the book of Ezekiel chapter 14. Ezekiel chapter 14. Good to hear them pages turning. Good you brought your Bible with you this morning. Stand with me if you would, please. We'll begin with the one in Hebrews 11. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 7. The Bible says, "By faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world, and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith." Now also the book of Ezekiel chapter 14 and verse 14 and verse 20. Here's what it says. "Though these three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, saith the Lord God." Drop on down verse 20, same chapter. "Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness." Brother Herb, pray for the preaching, please. Amen. You can be seated. Last Sunday, we kicked off 2020. Our theme, really, for this year is more of God. More of God. Too many folks want less of God. We need more of God. Amen? And that's the desire of our heart. So January, we're kind of doing a series of messages on that theme. But listen to me, and I mentioned this last week very briefly. Before you can get more of God, you got to have some of Him. Right? Before we can have a better or closer relationship with God, we first of all have to have a relationship to begin with. And that's what we're going to look at a little bit this morning. We need to first be with God. Just as Noah, as we saw in the scripture, Hebrews 11 and verse 7, as Noah built the ark, you know what? You was either in the ark or you was outside the ark. You was either in or out. There was no in between when the flood came. And I want you to look at this down in Ezekiel. We'll come back to Hebrews in a minute. But this scripture in Ezekiel 14, verse 14, I'm going to read it again. It says, though these three men, notice, three men, Noah, Daniel, and Job, were in it, they should deliver but their own souls by their righteousness, saith the Lord God. And we see they're mentioned again down in verse 20, these three men, though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in it, as I live, saith the Lord God, they shall deliver neither son nor daughter, they shall but deliver their own souls by their righteousness. Keep that thought in mind, by their righteousness. What kind of a day was it back in Ezekiel's day? Well, kind of like today. Be quite honest with you, it was a time of darkness over the land. There was political problems, there was economic problems, there was spiritual apostasy going on. The spiritual apostasy had basically about consumed the land, and because of their rebellion, listen, God's getting ready to bring judgment. Because of the rebellion of the people. The people of God, they didn't need God, they didn't want God. Because of their rebellion, God is getting ready to bring judgment on them. As we're going to see here, it's going to fall upon them in Ezekiel's day. But as the scripture we just read to you, our text, you know, I think it reminds us that even in the midst of a dark day, Ezekiel reminds us that there was still some men that stood for God. There was still some men that had some, remember that word, righteousness about them. Righteousness, right with God. And we see that even in the midst of an unrighteous world, here was examples of three men that had righteousness with God. You know, today our world looks a little dark sometimes. I think today it looks a little doomed on occasion because of the apostasy in our land. But you know what? Here's what I think. I think we can still shine for Jesus. Amen? Amen? I believe we can still shine bright for Jesus. You know what? We got a message of hope. His name is Jesus. We've got a message with some victory in it, the Lord Jesus Christ. But you know what? To prove that we can still have the victory, really Ezekiel goes back and he visits three different time zones. I mean, these three men did not do this all in the same day. It was kind of like three different periods of time that he uses as these examples of these three men. There was Noah, there was Daniel, and there was Job listed in these verses. And there's something that these three men all did. You know what? They all had something in common. They all lived for God in a difficult day. And brother, if they, you know what? The God of certainly Noah was the same God of Daniel, was the same God of Job. By the way, He's our same God this morning. And I believe we can still shine for Jesus and live strong for Christ even in a dark day. These three men had three things in common. First of all, they all lived for God when everybody else was living for the devil. Second thing they had in common, they all had the same attribute, righteousness. which means they was in right standing with God, right? Third thing they had in common, they had all experienced divine deliverance from God himself. Hey, God showed up in their lives. Amen? And so what is the message here? As we've just said, if Daniel can live for God, and if Noah can live for God, and Job can live for God, even after all that he went through, you know, he had a real encouraging wife, didn't he? Why don't you just go ahead and curse God and die? How'd you like to live with that? Right? But you know what Job said? I know that my Redeemer liveth. Amen. Praise the Lord. His victory was in God. And God brought deliverance into all three of these men's lives. As we think about our world, the chaos going all around us, and we live in pretty much a world of chaos right now, I believe, we can still stand for God. Now go over to our scripture in Hebrews, and let's put this all together. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, by faith Noah. We're just going to look at one man. You know, they all did a work for God, but let's look at the work that Noah did for God. It says that by faith Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. Listen, here is Noah, and he did a work for God. You know, look around, and you got to admit, we're kind of living in a day just like Noah did, aren't we? I mean the wickedness that's going on and the imaginations of men's heart these days. Now, you stay right there in Hebrews because I'm coming right back to it. But if we would look back in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5, it says, "And God saw the wickedness of man was great on the earth, and that every imagination of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually." And by the way, I think God could look down from heaven this morning and still see a whole lot of that going on. Listen, rebellion and apostasy, it was the norm for the day of Noah. And you know what? And God is getting ready to bring a judgment that's going to fall upon this antediluvian society. I mean, Genesis 6, 8, "But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord." Praise God. He found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Now let's look just for a little bit this morning, either till I get done or until the voice quits. Let's look this morning and see some of the work for God that Noah did. First thing I want you to see is the purpose. Notice the purpose of Noah's work. Why did God call Noah to this work to build an ark? The answer was really in our text. You know what? God warned Noah of a coming judgment, right? God, that was the purpose for the ark. It was in a preparation for a coming judgment from the God of heaven. And you know what? And Noah responded to the call of God. In fact, that scripture in verse 7 said that Noah moved with, remember that word? With fear. Noah moved with fear, as we see here in the scripture. You know, I understand this. The purpose was the judgment was coming. But even back then, now I know what John 3:16 says. That's why Jesus went to the cross and died for our sins. For God so loved the world. Hey, I can tell you, even back in Noah's day, for God so loved the world, he saved Noah and his wife and his three sons and their three wives. Oh, listen, even in a time of judgment, God brought safety to those that loved him. Noah must have said with fear. Now, keep that word in mind. He said with fear. He moved with fear. I think it means he must have got up and said, "Man, I got to do this quickly. I got to get busy here. With fear. I got to get to it." He didn't put it somewhere down on the calendar and thought, and think, "Well, I got about 120 years to get this job done. I think I'll just, plan it." No, I think with fear, he got to it right then. He got busy. And so we find here in the scripture, with fear, he moved. I believe with fear, he said, I've got to get up and Man, I gotta get this refuge built. Hey, the storm's coming, right? The storm is coming. And some of you here this morning asking, you know, what does that have to do with us? Is this really relevant to us this morning? I got to tell you it is, because the storm's coming for us too. Listen, God's judgment is going to fall on this world as we know it. I believe that with all of my heart. Someone said many years ago, we know how God brought destruction, fire and brimstone upon Sodom. And somebody said, I don't even recall who did, who said this several years ago. It may have been Billy Graham, but I'm not even sure about that. But if God's judgment holds off much longer, he'll owe Sodom an apology. Well, I don't believe God owes anybody an apology, but I know what the man of God was saying. Listen, judgment is going to fall upon America someday. And we need to be getting ready for the storm. Listen, the storm clouds are gathering. God's judgment is knocking at the door. But I got good news for all of you. Jesus came to save sinners. Amen. Amen. Jesus came to save sinners. There's a refuge today, and it's in the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, over 2,000 years ago, Jesus provided my refuge. When he shed his blood on the cross, died in my place. You know what? So what do we need to be doing? Well, we need to be doing what Noah was doing. We need to be doing a work for God. Hey, work while it's still day. Work before the judgment falls. Get all we can consider. You know, you got to realize this. And every time I read that, I'm reminded of this. When God told Noah to build the ark, why? You know, Noah must have maybe in his mind, why, God? And God must have surely said, it's going to rain. And Noah must have surely said, what's rain? It had never rained a drop. Listen. And God said, build the ark. And Noah must have maybe thought in his mind, what's an ark? Hey, it's going to rain, and there's got to be a refuge. There's got to be a place of safety. Because everybody else is going to drown. Everyone else is going to die in the great flood. Oh, listen. So I believe that not only did he move with great fear, I got to tell you, I believe Noah moved with real faith. And that's what put him in the hero chapter of Hebrews 11. By faith. When God told him it's going to rain, you better build an ark, everybody else is going to drown. He believed God of something he had not yet seen. And yet he believed God, didn't he? And he moved with fear to get the job done. By the way, the rain hadn't even started falling yet. He didn't wait till the first drop fell. He started quickly, I believe. You know what? Noah had a window of opportunity to get the job done. And every one of us here in God's house this morning, you know what I believe? I believe we've all got a window of opportunity to serve the Lord. We don't know how wide that window is. We don't know how long we have left here on earth. We really don't. Some of you is young. Some of you is older. There's a big variance of age in the building here. But I can tell you one thing this morning. As far as I can see, the death rate in America is 100%. Because everybody's going to die. Everybody's going to die. And understand this. So we got a window of opportunity. How long you got? I don't know. It's time to with fear move. It's time to with fear do something for God. It's time to get the ark ready for your family. Amen? Before the storm of judgment comes. So God gave Noah a purpose for the work. Judgment is coming. The second thing I want you to see that God gave Noah, he gave him plans for the work. He just didn't say, well, now, Noah, man, everybody's going to drown that ain't on the ark. Go out there and build a boat. Again, Noah would have probably said, what's a boat? We see here God gave him very clear-cut plans on the work that needed to be done. Can you imagine when God said to Noah, it's going to rain here again. What's that? And talked about the ark. God gave Noah the plans to build the ark. Now, this day and age, if you want to know how to do something, all you got to do is go to YouTube and somebody will tell you how to do it. Right? Back then, there was no YouTube or any kind of thing of the such. There was no other directions but what God gave. There was no other plans but God's plans. And Noah moved with fear to get the job done. I mean, as we begin seeing here, Noah's just going to simply trust God to do exactly what God told him to do, and in God's time, do it quickly. He looked to God for the plans, and he trusted God. I'm going to read that again, Hebrews 11, 7. That verse is just full of so much. It says, by faith, Noah, being warned of God of things not seen as yet, hadn't started raining yet, moved with fear, prepared an ark to the saving of his house, by the which he condemned the world and became heir of the righteousness which is by faith. You know what? God gave Noah the plans. Church, can I tell you this morning, God has given us the plans. If you got your Bible with you this morning, you're holding the plans right there in your hands. God has given us the plan of life right here. The plan of salvation. The plan of how to get forgiven of sin. The plan of how to go to heaven one day when the death knocks at our door. You know, repent of sin. Accept Jesus as our Savior. You know what? Hey, get saved and get in the boat that's going to float. Right? I mean, give your heart to Christ and get in the place of refuge this morning. God told Noah, excuse me a minute. God told Noah why to build the ark. Judgment's coming. God told Noah how to build the ark. And when I say how, if you read the scripture very clearly, you'll see he told him exactly how long and exactly how wide and exactly how tall. He gave him exact instructions how to build the ark. God even told Noah where to put the door. Won't you stay with me now? He even told him where to put the door. God did not tell him to put a door. He told him to put the door. Right? The door. There's only one door, and it's in the side. It's the door. It was the only way. It was not a way. It was the only way anybody was going to get in the ark. Are you getting this? Brother, we don't have a door or somewhat of a door. We have the door. His name is Jesus. The only way you're going to ever get into the ark of God's safety and God's salvation, you got to go in the side door, right? You got to go in the door. Jesus Christ is the only way to get into the ark of God's salvation. You know what that means? There was only one door in the side of this great ark. It was the door to get in. That means the elephant and the rabbit went in the same door. That means the giraffe and the little kitty cat all went in the same door. And brother, I tell you what, I don't care who we're talking about today. If you get saved, you're all going in the same door. There's no other door. There's no other way in. His name is Jesus, our Savior. It wasn't put in the front. It wasn't put in the back. But everything that escaped the flood had to go in this door, and it was in the side. What does that represent? What is that symbolic of? Well, listen, over 2,000 years ago, Jesus hung on the cross, and they pierced his side, didn't they? I think of the side, and I think of this great ark. It was the side door. And you know what? And by the way, that's how I got saved. I didn't go in a door. I went in the door. And this morning, you can't tell it just by looking at me, but I'm in God's ark of salvation right now. I'm in the ark of safety. Let the storm clouds come by and let the judgment of God fall. Whether we live or we die, praise God. We're in the ark of safety, aren't we? Hey, we went in the door. Hey, Jesus is the door. Understand that Jesus is His name. So everybody that gets saved from the coming flood has to go in that same door. Now, I like this too. There's so much to this message. There really is. Now, Noah and his family, when they got in the boat, who shut the door? It wasn't Noah. He didn't holler at his wife and say, "Honey, you get the door." That didn't work. It wasn't his sons. The Lord shut him in. That's exactly what the way it reads. The Lord shut him in. God shut the door. You say, boy, think about that. Now, some of you are old enough to remember the first time you went into a store and you stepped on one of those rubber mats and the door opened up by itself. How old are some of you anyway? You remember that? I heard somebody say the other day, "You know how old I am? I am pre-Walmart. I'm before Walmart ever was." Anyway, you think about that automatic door. Well, God automatically shut the door for him. What God shuts, no man can open. Listen, the Lord shut the door. And we see this. Noah steps out there on that plank of amazing grace, and God shuts the door. And I can tell you, once God shut the door, this isn't hard to figure out. This is easy math. Once God shut the door, you's either in or you's out. You's either in or out. You's either safe on the inside, or you're going to drown in God's judgment. You're going to die because of the judgment of God. That's just exactly the way it is. It's that simple. So God gave him a purpose. Judgment's coming. God gave him a plan. Here's how to build it, and here's where to put the door. And third thing I want you to see, and I'll be done. Then God gave Noah the most wonderful thing. Now, whatever you do, don't miss this. God gave Noah the most wonderful thing. He gave him his presence. Because God was with him in the ship. God was with him in the ark of safety. Knowing his family was not alone, God was with him. I want you to see this in Genesis 7, verse 1. Genesis chapter 7, verse 1 kind of makes this clear. And the Lord said unto Noah, who's talking? God's talking. Who's he addressing? He's addressing Noah. Here's what he says. Come thou. Does that mean anything? I mean, God's already inside the ark. He didn't say, Noah, go in there. He said, Noah, come in here. Hey, come thou and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. Praise the Lord. When we get saved, we go through the one door, the door, Jesus. And once we go through that door, Jesus says, I'll never leave you or forsake you. Amen? Hey, we also get blessed with His presence in our life. I don't have to live without Jesus anymore. Hey, you know what? He's in the ark of safety with me. Praise the Lord. I mean, that's the victory we have today. We that love the Lord Jesus. Come thou in and be saved. Saved in the boat. God's with you. It reminds me of the scripture over in Matthew 11, I believe, where Jesus says, come unto me all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. Hey, come on in. Hey, come on in where it's safe. I mean, and let me ask you this. Took him over 100 years to build this ark. When he got it all done, all the animals from the littlest to the biggest went inside. Noah, his wife, his three sons, their three wives, and God shut the door, and the rain started. I'm telling you, all the folks, do you not think for a moment that they mocked Noah when he built this ark? Made fun of him, laughed at him, cursed him. Listen, he was the joke of the whole area, I'm sure. He's building an ark because it's going to rain and they ain't never seen a raindrop in their life. He was the joke. But I tell you what, when God shut the door and the water started rising, I think if we could have heard the screams on the outside and the folks clawing at that door to get in, but God had shut the door. Amen. Hey, this is serious. God had shut the door. Now here's the question I wanted to ask you. All of a sudden, the place is flooded. Everybody has perished, left on earth. Only one safe's on the inside. Do you think that boat had any leaks? You know why it didn't leak? God told him even how to keep it from leaking. He said to pitch the walls, to put pitch on the inside of the walls of this ark. That's exactly the word that is used. Can I tell you the word pitch translated in the Greek? This ought to stir you up. Means atonement. The word pitch in the Greek means atonement. Listen, it's by the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ we are sealed unto the day of redemption. I mean, man, the walls have been pitched for you and me. And my boat isn't going to spring a leak as long as I'm trusting in Him. Praise the Lord. Man, this would really preach if a guy had a voice, wouldn't it? Now, this is the end of the story. You're going to like this. Many days has went by. The rain stops. And this ark finally rests up on Mount Ararat, high in the mountain. By the way, they think they have found this thing. There's some evidence they've found. You know, I mean, a lot of the wood is, what do you call it, petrified, or I don't know if that's the word I'm looking for. But anyway, make a long story short, it has now settled down. The waters is receding. How are they going to get out of the ark? And it says nowhere about God opening the door. You know how they got out? Go back and read the story when you get home. They took the roof off. They took the top off the ark to get out. Brother, when one day, when breath leaves my body and my heart beats the last beat, when I leave this old vessel behind, I'm going out the top. You knew I was getting at something there, didn't you? That's what I was getting at. Brother, I'm going up. I'm not going out the side, I'm going up. I can think of no reason why you wouldn't want to get into that ark of safety this morning. Hey, judgment's coming. You need to be saved. You need to know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. I mean, you're either on the inside of the ark with God and safe and secure and forgiven and justified, and the walls have been pitched. And I mean, the atonement, the precious blood has paid our price, and we're saved and we're heaven bound. Or you're on the outside. By the way, if you die on the outside, there's no hope for you. You will die lost. You will die without Jesus. You will die without salvation. Can I tell you what God told Noah back there in Genesis 7, verse 1? Why don't you come on in? Amen? It's time to come on in. Come to Jesus. He wants to get you on the inside where it's safe. Just come to Him. Let's stand. Our Father, we come to You this morning in Jesus' name. Lord, I pray we brought Your message. And I pray that it somewhere has found lodging in some hearts that are here today. If there's anyone in this crowd that is not saved, they're not a Christian, they've never trusted Christ. Oh Lord, I pray they've give heed to the warning. Storm clouds are gathering. Judgment's going to fall one day. And there's one thing for sure, there'll be a day they die. And Lord, if they're not on the inside of the ark of safety, if they haven't went through the door, Jesus, to get on the inside, they'll for sure die on the outside without Christ, without hope. Lord, I pray meet every need in this service. We're going to thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. You come. Come on in. Come on in. Hey, come on in where it's safe. Come to Jesus. Said amen. God bless you this morning. Good being in the Lord's house. Really is. Looking for a good service tonight. Praying, Lord, really bless our worship this evening as only He can. God bless you. Let's sing our song.